been here 6 years now, and really, when we moved down here, we had mixed emotions about it because we've lived in Rock Hill, York area our whole life. But I think for me and him, I can say 6 years ago when God called us here, you know, he was calling us home, that we consider this our home. And we consider lots of you other mamas and grandmamas, so happy Mother's Day from us as well. So I'm confident to say that there are a lot of treasured women in this room this morning.
Amen.
Would you agree?
Amen.
Just a lot of deeply treasured women, whether it be your mom or your grandmother or just a woman you look up to. Well, that's what we're going to look at today. We're going to look at a woman in the Bible that I think is somewhat overlooked sometimes, and but she's deeply cherished. And so today's message is called A Woman Treasured. And so if you will, I'm going to ask you to turn to Acts chapter 9. Okay, and once you're in Acts chapter 9, if you'll just scroll down to verse 36, we're going to start there. When you're there, if you'll say amen.
Amen.
First of all, let me say, doesn't the stage look really nice this morning?
It does.
We tried to get rid of some of the formalities and make it a little cozy for you, so you just feel free to take your shoes off and just stay with us a while, okay? All right, let's start reading in verse 36. In Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha, which is translated Dorcas. She was always doing good works and acts of charity. In those days, she became sick, and she died. After washing her, they placed her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples heard that Peter was there, and they sent two men who begged him, "Don't delay in coming with us." So Peter got up, and he went with them. When he arrived, they led him to the room upstairs. And all the widows approached him, weeping and showing him the robes and the clothes that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Then Peter sent them all out of the room. He knelt down, prayed, and turning toward the body, he said, "Tabitha, get up." She opened her eyes, saw Peter, and sat up. He gave her his hand, and he helped her stand up. He then called the saints and the widows, and he presented her alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. So let's pray before we get started, okay? Jesus, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for this opportunity this morning. And thank you for everyone who's here. And Lord, I'm just going to ask this morning that you just block out any distractions. And Lord, I know I feel so undeserving and so unworthy to stand up here and to teach out of your word to these wonderful people. But Lord, I'm just going to ask somehow, some way, if you'll just use me as your vessel this morning. I'm going to ask that you just give me confidence and to preach, Lord, with your power and not my own. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so before we start digging in, I told Tucker and Noah that we were going to be talking about a lady named Dorcas this morning, and they thought that was hilarious, that her name was Dorcas. They were like, "What? That is such a dorky name. Who would name their kid Dorcas?" So let's just get her name straight really quick. Some of your Bibles may say Tabitha. Some of them may say Dorcas. Well, her name is Dorcas. And in the Bible, Dorcas is actually meant as a, the meaning is gazelle, which is known as an emblem of beauty in the Bible. And her Jewish name is Tabitha. So they're the same person. So now that we all got that straight, and I promise you by the time we're done, you're really going to like the name Dorcas. You might name your next kid Dorcas. So today I just want to talk about what kind of woman Dorcas was. And my first point is she was a woman after God's own heart. And a lot of us are, Jamie, if you'll go ahead and flip it for me. A woman after God's own heart. A lot of us are familiar in the Bible with David, and in the Bible it says David was a man after God's own heart. Well, Dorcas certainly was. If you look back in verse 36, it says, in Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha. Well, I don't know about you, but when I hear the word disciple, I mean, I know that this person is recognized and known for being a believer and a servant and just an absolute true follower of Jesus Christ. Amen. She's not just your average, I'll show up for church when it's a holiday or a special occasion. No, she lived it out every day. Her heart was on fire for him. And let's just go ahead and get our timeline straight. This would have been like 3 years after Jesus had came to earth. He had died and he had rose again. So this is fairly early in the church being established. And in some history notes I read about Joppa and about Dorcas, I read that that there was a Christian church established in Joppa by Philip, and that most likely Dorcas was saved under the teachings of that church. And it actually said that she resided in a home by the sea and that she hosted prayer meetings in her home. And so, I don't know about you, but that's kind of what I picture when I hear the word disciple. Somebody that's just full of the Holy Spirit and just taking care of others and hosting prayer meetings in her home. That's what I think about when I hear somebody say disciple. So, if you go on and read in verse 36, it says, she was always doing good works and acts of charity. So that just confirms, like, she wasn't just your average, yeah, I believe in Jesus and I go to church sometimes. No, she was a disciple. She was a true follower of Jesus. Her whole life centered around him. And so she was always putting others' needs before her own. So, Zach, he's an avid book reader, right?
Mm-hmm.
He likes to read a lot. I'm not really one to sit down and just read a book. I'm a mama of three and a wife of Zach, so I stay pretty busy all the time. So, I don't get to read too much, but one of the last books I did read was a great read. It was called Kisses from Katie, and it was about, has anybody ever read that book? Okay, well, anyways, it's about this girl named Katie Davis, and she's from Tennessee, and she's a senior in high school, and she goes on her Christmas break, she goes to Uganda on a mission trip, and she gets such a heart for these people that she comes back and she tells her parents, I don't know if I want to go to college, I think the Lord's calling me to Uganda, and of course, as parents, they were like, a little hesitant, like, are you sure you want to do this? You're not going with anybody. You'll be by yourself. Do you think this is the wisest decision? All your friends are going to college. But she was just adamant the Lord's calling her to Uganda. So she graduated high school, and she went over there with a commitment to teach for 1 year. She was like a kindergarten or a first grade teacher. So she stayed there for her first year. Well, after the year was up, she just couldn't leave those people. That was her burden, were those people from Uganda. So at just 18, 19 years old, she started this ministry. And I can't remember the name of it, but she ended up adopting like 13 orphan girls at just 19. So she became a mama of 13 girls at just 19 with nobody else over there, just her. I mean, how brave is she? You know? But when I read this about Dorcas, I thought about her because she's just a girl that just, her life just centered around Jesus. She just breathed them in and breathed them out. And you can just tell by her fruits. So she's still there today. She's still fairly young. I would assume she's probably in her early 20s. And I did read that she was married now and she has another child of her own. So her and her husband have 14 children over there and run that ministry. So we talked about Dorcas was a woman after God's own heart. So I'm just going to ask you this morning to evaluate your heart. Are you a woman after God's own heart? Are you a man after God's own heart? You know, does everything in your life center around Jesus the way it seemed that Dorcas did? Are you always putting others before yourself like she was? So just think about yourself and evaluate yourself. So let's move on to the second thing we can learn about Dorcas. And that was that she was a woman of influence. Let's look back at our scripture and see how. So let's look in verse 37. It says, washing her, they placed her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples heard that Peter was there, and they sent two men who begged him, "Don't delay in coming with us." So Peter got up and he went with them. When he arrived, they led him to the room upstairs, and all the widows approached him. They were weeping and showing him the robes and clothes that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Okay? So what can we see here? They went and got Peter. She had passed away. Peter shows up. What's going on? All these widows start approaching him, and they're holding these clothes, and they're just so upset. Why are they so upset? They're upset and distraught because this woman had impacted and influenced their lives so much. So what can we figure by reading this? Well, it sounds like to me Dorcas was a seamstress. And I know there's a lot of women in here that sew, isn't there? Raise your hand if you know how to sew. I know my mom's in here, and she sews, and I send her something every week to trim up for me or him. Isn't that right, Mama? But Dorcas was a seamstress, and can you imagine how tedious a job that would have been back then? It's not like she had a Singer sewing machine back then in her home. She would have had to do all these things by hand, and who's to say she didn't have to make her own fabric, too? So, in Proverbs 31, when it speaks of the virtuous woman, it says, in verse 20, it says, her hands reach out to the poor, and she extends her hands to the needy. So wouldn't you say that Dorcas really reached out to those women, those widows specifically, in her community and touched them by giving them garments and clothes? I mean, maybe they were in need. Maybe their husband passed away and they didn't have a way to provide for themselves and they needed clothes. Maybe she just made them an article of clothing to give to them to make them feel better because they were grieving their husband. I don't know why she did it, but she did it as a ministry and she impacted and touched them. And not only just the women in her community, but Joppa was a port city. So there was a lot of traffic coming in, a lot of traffic going out. I mean, who's to say how many people she touched that she just crossed paths with? I mean, there's no telling how many people she influenced. But it sounds like to me that Dorcas was so influential because she found her place in the body of Christ. Sewing was her trade. That was what she was passionate about. That's how she reached others.
Amen.
And when you find your place in the body of Christ, it's a beautiful thing.
Amen.
And so the first person I think of when I think of somebody who's found their place in the body of Christ is my son Noah. And he's actually my birthday boy this week because he's going to turn 9 on Tuesday. But I think about him. For his birthday, he's always wanted to be a mascot. And for his birthday one year, he asked for a mascot suit, and he got one. And that's him in the Dalmatian suit, and that's my niece in the lion suit. But Noah, at 8, 9 years old, has already found his place in the body of Christ. He just loves being the church mascot. You'll see him at the Lord's lunchbox. You'll see him delivering meals. You'll see him in our driveway waving at cars. He'll take selfies with you. I mean, he just brings joy to people. That's what he's passionate about, and that's what he's good at. And he's found his place, and he just thrives, and he shines because of it. He can be the church mascot as long as he wants to be, because that's his place in the body of Christ, and God uses him. Somebody else I think of is Miss Barbara Cohen. I think about her, and there's a lot of other ladies in here that I think of for this very same reason. I mean, we've been here 6 years, and Miss Barbara's always in that kitchen. I mean, she knows that kitchen like the back of her hand. On Wednesday afternoon, she's in there making meals for shut-ins. On Wednesday evening, she's there making meals for all of our children's ministry. On Monday nights, we used to serve dinner to our seminary students, and she would come and help me there. Miss Barbara might not be a Sunday school teacher or a secretary, but in the kitchen is where she serves. That's her place in the body of Christ, and she thrives at it. So I think about her. I think about Robin Dixon. I think about him. I went to Haiti with him a few years ago, and he carried his guitar down there. And I watched because he was so funny. He didn't want any of those kids at the orphanage touching his guitar. And just a few days into that trip, I look over there, and there's kids all all over that guitar. He's showing them how to play it and all. He comes back from Haiti. He goes to a school, learns how to build guitars. So now he builds guitars and sends them to missionaries all around the world. He found his place, and he thrives at it. He's passionate about it. The Lord's using him. I think about Kayla Case. Kayla, you deserve that gift. You see all this up here? This was all Kayla Case. She has such an eye for design. Our Christmas play that we did here at the church, she made the children's costumes, like the little lambs and the little cows. She's just got a mind for creativity and an eye for design, and she uses that talent to glorify the Lord. So I think about her. But maybe you're like me, and I've really struggled with finding my place in the body of Christ. So being a mom of three, like I said, life is hectic, to say the least. And lots of times I don't get to serve in various ministries because I just feel like I can't devote all of my attention to that, or I just can't because I've got the kids with me or something. So I kind of struggle finding my place. Well, here in the last couple of years, I really feel like I've found my place. I'm a mama duck. Now, let me explain that. So any mama in here that has little ones will understand what I'm saying. But at home, I feel like a mama duck. Have you ever seen, like, a real duck and walking across the street, and you'll see her little ducklings following behind? I feel like that at home most days. I feel like a mama duck because I've got these three little ducks always around me saying, I need something to drink. Can you fix this? Can you fix that? And I'm always just mothering them and telling them what to do, what not to do, fixing their food, cleaning their clothes. I'm just a mama duck. Well, on Wednesday nights, we have this huge children's ministry, most of you know. Zach and I teach kindergarten and a handful of first graders. And I think we broke our record this Wednesday because we had 38, didn't we? So we had 38 kindergartners and maybe about 5 or 6 first graders. Well, on Wednesday nights for a little over an hour, I feel like a mama duck. I'm running around and I've got 30 little ducks behind me telling me what they need, and I'm cutting their food and I'm wiping their noses and I'm tying their shoe and I'm telling them about Jesus and I'm loving on them when they get hurt. And I can be a mama duck. I can do that because that's what I do every day at home. That's what I'm passionate about. I love being a mama. I'm good at it, if I'm allowed to say that. And that's where I thrive. That's my place in the body of Christ. It may not seem like much, but that's my little bitty place in the body of Christ.
Amen.
So I want you to understand, no matter how menial the task may seem, whether you're a nursery worker or Jamie running the sound system for us, or you clean up sometimes at the church, or whatever you do, or you're a mama duck, it's important. Your place in the body of Christ is so important.
Sure.
And if you find your place in the body of Christ, you would be so surprised how many people you touch and influence just the way Dorcas did.
Amen.
So we talked about she was a woman after God's own heart. And we talked about how she was a woman of influence. Lastly today, I want us to talk about how treasured she was. And that brings me to number 3. She was a woman who was deeply, deeply treasured. And in my opinion, I think that she was treasured in 3 special ways. Number 1, I think she was treasured by those widows after her passing. She had lived out Christ in front of them, and she had touched their lives in a special way, and they treasured her, and it hurt those widows when she did pass. So she was treasured by the widows. Secondly, I think she was treasured by God. How can we figure this out? Well, of course, God treasures his children, but I think he treasured Dorcas in a special way, because in the Bible, there's only 10 people that have been raised from the dead, including Jesus himself. And Dorcas was one of those 10. So I think it's safe to say that he treasured her in a special way, and he used her to perform a miracle, and she was treasured and used for his glory. Would you agree?
Amen.
Okay. Okay, so, and thirdly, I think she's treasured by all of us. She's in our hearts today. We read her story in God's Word. And verse 42, if you'll look there, it says, "This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord." It sounds like to me a revival broke out. It sounds like to me she influenced and touched all these people. Peter came, he raised her from the dead. All these widows saw what was going on, and this story just kept getting passed down and passed down, and revival broke out in Joppa. And even today, we're sitting here reading this story today, and it's touching our lives. So she's treasured by us. And, you know, many came to know Jesus because Dorcas lived her life as a servant. And she lived every day honoring him, and she was fulfilling the Great Commission. So when I started putting this message together, my first thing I started thinking of was when the Lord told me I was going to talk about a treasured woman, I started thinking about something in my life that I just treasure and hold dear to my heart. Y'all mind if I go sit in the rocking chair? Y'all don't mind, do you? I'm going to go sit in the rocking chair because it'll be a good spot for this story. Okay, so I was thinking about something that I treasure. And the first thing that came to my mind was a piano that sits in my dining room. And the piano belonged to my great-grandmother. I called her my Nana. And the reason this piano means so much to me is because growing up, when I would go to her house, she had this really big dining room, or like extra living room, I guess you would call it. And she would sit at that piano and she would play. And when I was a little girl, I liked to perform. I don't know if any of you have granddaughters or daughters that like to perform, but I like to sing. I like to sing and dance and twirl around. So my Nana would sit there at that piano and play, and I would put on a show. And she would have this great big window in there with these curtains, and you could go over to the side and pull this chain like this, and the curtains would open like this. So I thought it was like a Broadway stage. So I always just loved going over there, and I cherished that piano. Well, when my Nana passed away years ago, another grandchild got the piano, but then he decided he didn't want it anymore. Well, I jumped on it, and I said, "I want it," because I just treasure it so much. And so now we've got it, and it sits in our house. And, you know, none of us play the piano. It sits there. It looks pretty. But, you know, when I really think about it, it's not the piano that I treasure. It's my Nana that I treasure. It's those memories. It's the love that she shared with me, the things she taught me. It's her. That piano is just a daily reminder when I walk by it every day that was my Nana's. So that kind of made me think of the widows in this story. It wasn't those clothes that they were holding on to that they treasured so much. It was the woman who made them. And how she ministered to them and touched their hearts in a special way. So that story just reminded me so much of Dorcas and those widows. So in closing today, I want you to evaluate your heart. And I want you to think about the things we talked about today. And I want you to think about, do you have a heart like Dorcas had? Are you a woman? Are you a man after God's own heart? She was a woman of influence, and she was intentional about her influence. Are you intentional about who you influence? And I'm speaking to myself here, too, because, boy, I have a lot of work to do myself. But think about that. And also, not only don't think about who treasured you, who treasures you, but think about who's the true treasured one in this story. It's the Lord. It's our Savior. Wouldn't you agree?
Amen.
That's who Dorcas treasured. I mean, she treasured her salvation. She treasured her relationship with Jesus. And she lived out her life and showed it by her fruit. So she treasured the gift of a lifetime. She treasured her relationship with Jesus, and she nourished it. So this morning, thing. I just want to ask you, are you treasuring your relationship with Jesus? Do you treasure, do you thank God when he answers a prayer? Do you give him unending praise when he doesn't answer a prayer the way you want him to? You know, do you repent when you mess up and cry out to him and ask for forgiveness? Do you treasure that relationship that you're allowed to have with Jesus, and do you nourish it on a daily basis? Do you speak to God every day? That's what I want you to think about this morning. And so I'm just going to pray, and Jamie, if you'll start the music, we'll just have a time of prayer. And just a time for you to reflect on your heart. So let's pray. Jesus, thank you so much, Lord, for Dorcas. And Lord, thank you for what an example she is to us all. And Lord, I just pray as we have these few moments of time, a time of reflection, that we'll pray and we'll search our hearts and see really where we stand with you. Lord, help us to help us to want to have a heart like yours. Help us to be influential. Help us to find our place in the body of Christ, just like Dorcas did. And Lord, help us to treasure you. We don't want to forget you, and we don't want to forget the gift that you give us, Lord, that we're so undeserving of. Lord, thank you so much for your son. Thank you for your presence here this morning. Thank you for all of our mamas and all the others that are here today. Lord, just thank you, and I give you all the praise and glory this morning. Amen.
Amen. If you'll stand at this time, we're going to have a time of invitation. I think Summer said a mouthful at the very end when she said the treasure of the story.